Now this is the way how we beautify everything. So that beauty is important because appeal to our senses, five senses. After that, our mind do not reject, accept. So when we join religion and culture, both work together, one embrace the other. When culture and religion both join together, both are well protected. Culture protect religion. Religion promote culture. Culture get ideas from religion and enrich the culture. Religion get support from the culture to beautify, to introduce. See how, therefore, both are important. In all our activities, religious practices and ceremonies and everything, there is cultural aspect which appeal to others' mind, otherwise very dull. So religion must go hand in hand with our culture. So when we come to this cultural aspect, we differ. Chinese, Indian, Sri Lankan, Thai, Burmese, Japanese, Korean, European. Why? We try to practice this religion according to our own culture. Now this is very important. Others must know how to tolerate this. Not to condemn. Not to say that this is wrong. When Chinese practice Buddhism with their Chinese culture, Indians and others should not say, oh, this is not the way our Buddha has introduced. When Indian practice this religion, or Sri Lanka practice, Chinese should say, we don't like that method, this is very old-fashioned. That is their culture, that is their way of life. When the Japanese or Koreans or Westerners practice, they have some other method. And this is called tolerance in this religion. This cultural aspect support their own religion to maintain. Now, then come to the third stage. That is called intellectual. Intellectual means we try to improve our knowledge, our understanding through our religion. We try to learn what this life is, analyze. Or what is the nature of human mind? Why this world is like this? Why things exist and change and disappear, and after that, what will happen to them? Now we try to learn to get the clear picture of all these incidents, occurrences that which happen. Intellectual aspect. After developing this intellectual aspect, what will happen? We reduce our traditional and cultural practices. Because so far we have not developed the intellectual side. Then when you look at through intellectual angle, we can see certain things that we perform as our traditions and culture, just like small children's way of playing. You know, small children also build houses and all sort of thing, but they are very happy. That is their culture, children's culture. But when they grow, we see it is childish. So in the eyes of intellectuals, our traditions and cultural practices are not very important. But we should not try to follow intellectuals. We get lost in. We have to develop slowly, slowly, until we reach should not throw away our culture at once. One day when we developed our understanding, oh, this is dharma, this is the nature of life, that is how changes take place. This is the reason why people suffer, why people cannot satisfy with their life. Oh, these are the reasons, that intellectualism. Otherwise, you think charms, black magic, devils, ghosts and hantu, this is under ignorance. Still under ignorance. But after reaching that intellectual level, they do not talk about this hantu and ghost and spirit and devil. Nothing for them. Understanding of the Dhamma. But that is not enough. One more. That is called, last one is called a spiritual aspect. Spiritual aspect means complete purity in our mind, although we are intellect, very intelligent, can understand many things, our minds are not pure. Still we are jealous, we are greedy, we are hot-tempered. We have very strong egoistic ideas. Very impatient, so intolerance. All these weaknesses still remains in the mind. Although we are very intelligent. So, the mental purity means eradication of those weaknesses from our mind. That is called spiritual development, complete purity. Unless we complete the last item, there won't be final salvation for us. We have to go through this channel to reach the final goal. Our intellectual or knowledge cannot bring that. You can master, memorize the whole teachings of the Buddha, every word the Buddha uttered. You can remember. You are very intelligent. But your minds are not pure. Still you are greedy, hot-tempered. That means no spiritual development there. But many others develop their spiritual aspect without going through this intellectually. They are not intelligent, but through their confidence, they could manage to get rid of the mental impurities. That's why when you read many stories there in Dhammapada, you can see uneducated laborers, coolies, thieves also. After learning few words of the Dhamma from the Buddha, practicing meditation for a short period, they gain the spiritual development, attain the final goal. But there were many other intelligent monks at that time, but they could not gain that. That mental purity was not there in them. So the final target, final goal is the mental purity. When the purity appears in the mind, enlightenment natural. Enlightenment means brightness in the mind. Now there is no brightness in our mind, but more darkness, more dark clouds, because of evil thoughts, evil dark corners in our mind. So, there is no any other method to cleanse our mind. This is the only method. You can learn everything in this world, but still your minds are not clean. Learning is not the solution. Without learning anything, you try to cleanse your mind with confidence, using your full effort, you will reach. You need effort, confidence. You know, the bodhisattvas, before they gained their enlightenment or the Buddhahood, they were known as bodhisattvas. Those who work to become Buddhas are known as bodhisattvas. The bodhisattvas divide into three groups. Saddhadika, Viryadika, Prajnadika. Three groups. All the bodhisattvas which exist in this world, who are working to attain Buddhahood. One group of bodhisattvas develop more confidence and saddha. And all the other good qualities based on this, but not on intellect. Another group of bodhisattvas use full effort, virya, day and night, using their full effort and working and working and day and night, then all the other good qualities follow with effort. Another group of bodhisattvas use more knowledge and wisdom. Then cultivate all the other good qualities. The difference is only duration. For them to gain their enlightenment. Those who develop all the perfection, paramitas and good qualities with intelligence or wisdom, gain their enlightenment earlier. Because they can understand things easily. Those who develop their effort and practice all the other good qualities depending on their effort take longer period. Because in that effect, intelligence, wisdom is not advanced. Later, the development takes place. Wisdom. At the last moment, wisdom appears. Saddhadika, saddha, confident, faith. Based on faith or confidence, that means under any circumstances, never change their mind. That is called strong faith, confident. There is nobody in this world who can change their mind. They are willing to undergo any kind of suffering, but never change their mind. Kings, emperors, prime ministers, or anybody, any human being, change all their gadgets and take white piece of cloth exactly like this. Exactly like this. Wear like this. What is the idea? That color is the purity. Purity of the mind. Simple dress means humbleness. We must be humble in front of God. We have no differences, no discrimination. Whether this person is a king or a beggar, both are human beings in front of God. All are children of God. That is their belief. So differences we can show when we come back at home in our country, but not in front of God. So when we are going to observe religious practices, precept, participate, we must have very simple dress. We must be humble. Don't try to show off. So the place of worship is not for you to have fashion parade to show beautiful dress and ornament and decoration. So just pure white color without any decorations, simplicity, purity. These two things indicate simplicity and purity.
This question also relates to karma, but I think it's a follow-up. Good karma and bad karma, do they balance or offset each other, balance and offset, plus and minus, I think what they mean. Is there any plus and minus? Offset, balance and offset each other.
All these karmas that we have committed or accumulated or performed during our lifetime, categorized into 11 groups. Then measure in different ways how these karmas can affect, at what time, when, whether within this lifetime, if not, whether immediately after our death, if not, at any time, as long as we exist in this cycle of birth and death. So, into three periods. It depends on the nature or the gravity, the degree of our karma. Karmic result become big or small according to our way of thinking at that time, but not according to the action. So when we are going to do bad things, say killing, to kill a person, if we develop more and more anger, cruelty, jealousy, ill will, evil forces in our mind, then we increase so many degrees of that actions of killing. Because we have polluted the purity of the mind very badly. In other words, we have damaged our mind to do that. Then the effect of that karma also become very severe. On the other hand, instantly, without harboring, without creating ill will or jealousy or anger, suddenly idea appear in the mind that I want to kill. Kill on the spot, but did not pollute the mind for long period. Now let us take a murder case. Judges, study this case very carefully. Why this person murdered the other person? Then the judge found out, this man never had the idea earlier that he want to kill this person. In fact, he never had grudge or enmity also toward this person. Suddenly, his anger flared up. He could not control his anger at that time. So under the influence of this anger at that moment, he has taken this drastic action to kill on the spot. If the judges can understand the nature of that murder case, the judges never sentenced to death, no death penalty for this person. Now that is called culpable homicide, the legal term. That means without contemplating to kill, suddenly idea appeared and killed, and sent to life imprisonment, but no death penalty. Now, can you understand this? Now, this is the nature of karma. Even a minor thing, action, can become a very big good karma or bad karma if we develop this in our mind. Now you want to do a good karma. few months or few years you have been thinking, talking, discussing, contemplating to do this. Every time when you create such ideas in your mind, these ideas also create good karma. So when you completed that action, then it will become a very big karma, although action is a very minor thing. And the bad one also like that. I depend on our way of thinking. So, heavy karma, weighty karma, always get the chance to come forward. If not, nearest karma which has been functioning in our mind at the last moment when we are going to die. Maybe a very minor thing. Example. Assume here in this building there are so many buffaloes. You don't worry about that. I am not referring to you. Full house of buffaloes. Close all the doors at night time. You cannot go out. Early morning, somebody come and open the door, that door. One who was nearer to that door, maybe a small one, very old one, first get the chance to go out. There will be very huge fellows here, but they cannot go until the others go out. Understand? In the same way, when we are going to die, whatever karma it may be, which was dealing with the mind, functioning, active in the mind before our death, get the chance to condition, to produce our next life. There may be so many other powerful karmas, but no chance because another one was active in the mind at that time. That is why it is necessary for us to recall, repeat again and again and again all the good karmas that we have done. Then we may get the chance to recall a better karma, because we cannot create karmic thought purposely at that moment. Another point. Heavy karma and minor karma. Certain karmas, good and bad karmas, are very heavy, called weighty karmas, can affect or produce good and bad results for a long period. Not only one life, through life after life. Then, what are those karmas? Assume you have donated $5 only for this building when you started this. Every time when you come to this temple, when you see this building, the happiness that appears in your mind multiply your karmas. Again, when you think how people make use of this building, for what purpose? To enlighten others, to teach religion, to guide people, to bless. Oh, what a wonderful services. I also contributed something. Every time when you think, when you see, you feel happy, you multiply your karma. Then this will become a heavy karma later. On the other hand, you have done a bad deed. You have broken a leg of your enemy. And you feel very happy. So every time when you see that man, you enjoy happiness. I gave him properly, now see how he's suffering. You enjoy, that enjoyment create bad karma. The happiness that you gain to take revenge, what you have done, create bad karma. If you happen to see him every day you create more and more bad karma. And again you have to suffer more. This is the way how we multiply even ordinary karma to become a very big one. Whatever we do, by developing our greed, our anger, our ignorance, these are the three main roots of all the evil deed. Certain things we do by using only one of them, not three, if not two of them, sometimes three of them. Again, we do certain good things by reducing our selfishness, by reducing our anger, by reducing our ignorance. Then we increase the validity of this good karma. But many of us do lot of good deeds, good karma, by keeping all these three things. And then what will happen? The result or the effect that we experience also are very poor. Because there was no purity in the mind at that time when we perform this good karma. If there is purity in the mind, when you do that, we experience more good result. I think this is more than enough for you to understand.
Are we contributing to the demand of livestock to be slaughtered if we buy from the supermarket?
No.
One word, no.
Yes. No, no is no, that's all.
I think this question is a very intelligent question. Intelligent answer, very fast. I think this question the chief has just now answered. Please define what can be eaten after 12 noon. Can biscuits, tofu, fruits, etc. be eaten when taken? When taken? The eight precepts. During the observance of eight precepts, say after the 12 o'clock, can biscuits, tofu, fruits, etc. be taken?
No.
Especially chief has already said, solid food. Thank you.
Unless you are sick. If you are suffering from gastric troubles or problems or any other sickness, you are at liberty to take any kind of food at any time.
But chief, this question of tau kufa, you heard of it. It's very soft. soft bean curd jelly,
Tofu was not there during the Buddha's time, therefore he did not mention.
But I think those Ceylonese, the Singhalese type, with those milk curd, can that be taken also after the precept, after the noon meat? No, the sour one, yogurt.
I think that is too much. Slowly you are increasing now.
Started
from milk, now going up to yogurt.
This is like equivalent to the Chinese tofu fa and the Japanese tofu fa. So the yogurt.
Better not to take all the
things. That is my addition, tofu fa. Is it breaking the precept if I am a nurse assisting in the abortion that the doctor performs?
Yes. Yes, yes.
Yes, chief.
This is the danger of worldly life. Although we can understand that it is wrong, we have no other choice. According to our way of life, our job and our responsibilities, we have to do that. Only thing that we should not say that there is nothing wrong. We are responsible for that.
But the
effects differ. Doctors, attendants, nurses,
according to their way of thinking at that time. Different kind of effect, not the same.
Perhaps in common law, the nurses are complacent. So, something relating to Buddhism as well. I think it's better to ask the, yes, please.
Now, for instance, if the mother's life is at stake and this action has to be done, would the reaction be the same, taking a life?
Life is life. Whether mother's life or baby's life, life is life. Just now I told you in front of God, whether emperor or beggar, no different. Life is life.
Is there any question from the crowd? Is there any question from the crowd rather than I go through this? Still one or two questions.
This is a very good question which can give confidence, because other religions always say that they have their God to forgive your sins. If you have committed certain sins, just believe in God and pray. God has sympathy towards you, so you will be saved by God. Since the Buddha has never said that I can save you, or there is a Buddhist God who can save you, although you have committed certain sins, then some of our devotees may get some sort of frustration, so disappointment. So as Buddhists, so what are we going to do now? Is there any choice? In that case, why not we accept that religion? Because that religion promises to take away our sin. Buddhism say cannot. So I have to clarify this doubt. Yocha pubbe pamajjitva pachyaso na pamajjati soimang lokang pabhaseti abha mutto chandima. This saying of the Buddha you can see in Dhammapada. Nowadays we talk a lot about Dhammapada. Very meaningful saying, the Buddha saying, you can find in Dhammapada. The only thing, our people do not take the trouble to study and remember what the Buddha says. You always say what people say, but not what the Buddha says. People say like this. There's nobody to say the Buddha says like this. This is the answer given by the Buddha. Due to our ignorance or misunderstanding or under certain circumstances, assume we have done some bad deeds or bad karmas. One day we will come to know, or we realize, that the things or the bad thing that we have done earlier is very dangerous. Therefore, time has come for me to change my way of life. By considering in this way, decide to not to repeat, not to do certain bad things what these people have done earlier. That is the first stage. Second stage, from that day onward, do more and more good karmas and good deeds. That means some more service to others. Good deeds mean do some service to others. Then go on accumulating more and more good karmas. So we will be able to overcome or suspend or prolong the effect of the bad karmas that we have done earlier by using the good karmic thoughts that we have developed. and try to maintain more purity in the mind through meditation by reducing cruelty, anger, jealousy, grudge and greed. If the mind is pure, if the good karmic effects are active, then the bad deeds or bad karmas that we have committed earlier become powerless to affect us. Because these mental energy and the karmic forces become more energetic. And from that life onward, again the next rebirth, next existence take place in a favorable state by using through the influence of the karmas that we have accumulated later. But still, the bad karmic effect remains in the waiting list. They never disappear. From that life onward, again continue by doing more and more good deeds. Then, life after life, we can continue this until we attain the final goal, arhanthood or buddhahood or nirvana. And then the bad karmas in the waiting list automatically evaporate, extinguish, disappear, no chance to ever. See the way how we can forgive our own sins. There's another person cannot take away the sins. If they can forgive our sin, they can forgive our good merits also. Remember this. We should not worry too much about the past deed. Our understanding is very important. Still, it is not too late to change our way of life. Simply by praying and asking God to take away your sin, we, according to our understanding, it is impossible for another person to cleanse our life. But by doing more and more service to others, by maintaining purity in the mind, practical way, we can understand this is more effective. No, you are wrong. Buddha has emptied all his good and bad karma. Sit down. Wait. After his renunciation, Prince Siddhartha became a mendicant and he had been suffering by observing and practicing self-torture, self-mortification, because he was taught by the teachers to practice on this thing in order to gain his enlightenment. For 6 years he practiced, he could not gain anything. So when he was suffering like this, Mara, evil force, appeared in front of him and told him, "You are a young prince. Why do you want to suffer like this? Why not you go back? You can become the ruler of your kingdom. You can rule the country. At the same time, if you want to lead a religious life, you can do a lot of meritorious deeds, accumulate lot of merits. Why do you want to suffer like this?" Then the Buddha says this, "You must understand." First he said in English, "You must understand." And later he used his own language. Anumattena pi punyena attho maihan navijyate. You must understand, even a little bit of merits or good karma has nothing to do with me. I am not working to accumulate good karma. Good karma cannot do anything for me. What I am working for is to gain my enlightenment. These karmas cannot give me my enlightenment. So-called good karmas can provide us worldly, comfortable, pleasurable things for us to lead a worldly life, to become a human beings or devas or somebody else to enjoy our life. Karmas are important for them. But karma cannot give us nirvana. Karma cannot give us wisdom. Karma cannot make us Buddhas. After becoming the Buddha, to gain the Buddhahood, he had to drop all the karmas that he has accumulated. No more karmas. So, now what do you want to ask? Your karma also dropped, isn't it? So, karma is not the important thing. Karmas are important for us to lead a worldly life. Can go to heaven and enjoy, karma is important, but no complete liberation there, no freedom, no nirvana.
Two extremes or months that should be avoided by the person who is seeking enlightenment. The first is the indulgence in sensual pleasure. This is inferior, indecent, insignificant, dishonorable and profitless. The other extreme is indulgence in the practice of severe austerity. This is painful, inferior, and profitless. By abandoning these two extremes, the Tathagata, the Buddha, realized the middle path, which promotes vision and knowledge. Moreover, this leads to nirvana, peace of mind, deep insight, and complete awakening.
Katamāca sa bhikkhave majjhimā paṭipadā sattvāgīne.
What is this middle path, O monks, realized by the Tathagata? It is exactly this noble eightfold path, namely, right views, right thoughts, right speech, right action, right occupation, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. The truth of suffering is this: birth itself is suffering, old age is suffering, sickness is suffering, death is suffering, having to be with unpleasant ones is suffering, separation from the loved ones is suffering. In short, the five aggregates of existence connected with attachment are suffering.
Thank you.
the noble truth of the cause of suffering is this. It is this craving, tanha, which gives rise to re-existence. It is the craving that combines with enjoyment and attachment, seeks delights in this and that. This craving is threefold. The craving for sensual pleasure, the craving to become, the craving not to become.
Dankopan bhikkhave dukkha nirodham arya satyam yo tassa eva tanha raga nirodho jato pati sankhoti खोपन बिखरे दुख निरोधगामिनी प्रतिपदा अन्य सत्यानि अयमेव अर्यो अष्टांगिको मार्गो सैयतीदं सम्मादित्ति सम्मासंकप्पो सम्मा वाचा सम्मा कम्मन्तो सम्मा आजीवो सम्मा वायामो सम्मा सति सम्मा समाधि यथोचको मे बिखरे इमे सुतं स्वरे सत्ये देवं विपरिवर्तं द्वादशाकारं यथा भूतं ज्ञानदर्शनं सुरिशुद्धं अहो
regarding this four noble truths, I did not claim to have realized the Buddhahood, true, perfect enlightenment.
Yeah.
Thank you.